Oh, God, I hope we come up with something to talk about because there's subtle news.
Well,
hello.
We could...
Oh, go on.
No, I was saying we could talk about the fact that you still can't get AirPods.
I still can't get AirPods?
Yeah. They're still back ordered till, I don't know what, June?
I'll get you a pair from Birmingham. They're loads on the shelf.
There you go.
Okay.
AirPods. I've got another pair coming on April 5th as well.
Apparently that's something else Germany doesn't have either, is AirPods.
Yes, apparently.
So no Apple Pay and no AirPods.
And Apple Stores. No, we don't actually do.
Getting a brand new one. Aren't you?
True. Yes, in Cologne.
Yeah.
You're getting aftershave.
What are you complaining about?
No? Okay. Hello, welcome to the Mac Show. Yes, we're here to discuss all the big things that have gone on in Apple this week, and there aren't any. So we'll see you next week.
Yay, we're done.
We're done.
Thanks for turning cool.
in. Apple doesn't, Adam doesn't feel bad about turning up late now. Joining me to discuss the week in Apple, thank you so much to them for coming along, because I've forgotten to even change the big text away from it, but never mind, I'll sort that out in a second. Dot Rock, how you doing, brother?
Good, good. I'm sorry, I was caught off guard watching highlight reel of Edgar Davids that Steve sent to the chat. It's pretty good.
You've been whittling the shit out of some monkey stuff, haven't you?
Swirling the shit out of some monkey wood. That was pretty funny. Yes, it's called Monkey Pod, but I use monkey wood as a good name for it as well. Man, just having a good time. I'm very impressed by what this machine can do. And, you know, we always talk about how certain things were back in the day with the technology, and or remember when, and we're talking about like the old Mac, you know, SE30 and stuff. In my head, just, you know, out of pure dumbness, I was seeing CNC as sort of a relatively new thing because of the uptake of all of the homebrew type stuff. But CNC from like regular machinery, I found it this week, is going on like 30 years old. I didn't know.
Oh, yeah.
That. I thought it was, you know, the hot new thing, but yeah. It's
what,
pretty
CNC
impressive
is?
Nonetheless. Yeah.
Yeah, CNC's, you know, been around for
the
years.
Homebrew stuff is relatively new, but factory's been using this mess for a long time, but, you know,
right,
nothing that you would think about buying for yourself and sticking in your shop kind of thing.
No.
Yeah. No, well, here, anyway. Here I thought we were talking about CNC Music Factory. Sorry, I'm stuck in the
I remember that.
I thought we were talking about Command & Conquer.
Dumb joke, I used to get that a lot. Back in the day, because I had a long ponytail, and my friends used to call me Freedom.
just in case anyone wants to see it, is Doc's wood. There you go.
That's, notice the shape.
It is somewhat phallic, yes. But that's monkey.
Well,
that's monkey
I
wood.
Can man up here,
and it is gorgeous. The grain on it is fantastic.
Yeah, amazing.
That's a nice piece of wood you got there, Doc.
Nice wood, Doc.
Did I send you the picture of the prayer box that we made for one of the local churches? Because it shows you once it's cut up, like how gorgeous that stuff really is. Let me see if I can pop you over one in the chat real quick, and you'll really see how absolutely gorgeous that wood is. It is one of the most impressive stuffs ever.
Yeah, pop that wood over to Ewan.
I was trying to think of titles here. No news. No Apple news. So we looked at Doc's wood instead.
Alright, come on, Lee. Hurry up. Alright,
worth it.
Chatty chat. Alright, posting in the chatty right now.
Bronwyn's already voted for Doc's wood as the title, but I've got to get the word Apple in there, otherwise it doesn't do so well in iTunes.
Apple's wood.
Next to him, it's Adam.
Hey,
with his Apple hat on.
Yeah.
What did you do,
representing,
mate? What did you do? You've had a bit of a fetch up this morning, haven't you?
Oh no, yeah, no, we're good. I just I was a little late because I decided to deploy some code that I wrote last night to the live server right before the show.
And also, this is the traditional week where America manages to throw a real spanner in the ashtray try and stop us from getting to talk to each other. And they failed this year because you did DST last week and we're not doing it till next week.
Oh, yeah, that I hate too. We just need to kill that thing.
Yeah.
Why we still do frickin' DST is beyond me.
Because it's dark in Scotland at 9 o'clock in the morning. If you don't.
No. But I'm saying when it is when you're on it or off of it.
No, so GMT, if you don't do GMT, then it's dark in Scotland at 8:30 in the morning. So kids get knocked over, go out to school and stuff like that, which...
Right.
I can live with an hour time change to save them.
Yeah, I'd rather just stay on EST all year.
I was like, I had nothing to do with Scotland, but now I understand what you said.
What?
You said it was dark in Scotland. I was like, what? You said dark. I just, sorry. Waxy.
Okay.
Waxy ears.
Okay. Come. Thanks, mate. Don't leave him near any sharp objects. Next to him is Patrice. How you doing, brother?
Hey, guys. What's the beginning of the show, so I mean, even...
What's happening there, mate? What's been going off? What's been going on?
To be honest, not too much. I've had a workshop with people from all different countries and even someone in the US who was basically spending his night with us the entire week. So it has been fun, but also very exhausting.
Okay. And on a different time zone.
Yeah, on a different time zone as well from Phoenix. So yeah, it was interesting. They started with, I think 1 a.m. with us. So... What's interesting? Great guys. So,
if he was with Phoenix, though, Arizona doesn't do DST.
Yes, well, neither does Hawaii, does it?
No, we're the only two places.
Yeah, because we never have a problem. We always have a problem with Carrie next week because he changes next week for us if he comes on Big Show. So, never mind. And last but by no means least, our man in the Philippines on Blocker Vision.
Right on, man.
That might be my
We stretch end, it here. Stretch 4x3. Make it appear that we're in HD.
Back right in on. The studio with fixed air conditioner.
Yeah. Bastards.
So that's the thing. Is we all sit and complain in the winter here in the UK about the climate, but then we'd look at you like, and you, it's like a sweatbox for you all the time, isn't it? So
unless it is when you don't have an aircon on, yeah.
And then unless it rains, and then it's like being Alec Guinness in Bridge on the River Kwai in a metal box.
Pretty much, yeah. Yeah, that describes it perfectly.
Cool. Glad you live there, mate. Go, blimey.
Hey, at least we don't have daylight savings time.
I said to Sharon about coming out to visit with you guys, and she said, yeah, that'd be great. I'd love to see the Philippines.
Yeah. Come on.
Yeah,
we've got an extra room upstairs.
We can have two weeks in a traffic jam.
Pretty much, yeah. Yeah. By the time you get here, it'd be the time to leave, actually. So.
Yeah, from the airport.
Yeah.
There's Hopefully a round...
Enjoy your view. You'll enjoy your view of Etza, and then you'll be time to go home already.
Yeah, that'd be good. The week in Apple, what's gone on, what's been happening? Well, apparently there's going to be an iPhone that's going to be curved at the edges. Yippee, but who cares? And I just want to say a shout-out thanks to LG, because they've had some shielding issues with the new Ultra 5K monitors, and they sent me through the shielding kit for mine so I can retrofit it. There we go.
Sweet.
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's cut to size as well. Look, see? Look, perfect.
Yeah.
It's all right. I'll save that, and then I can make a tinfoil hat out of it during Big Show.
And then cook a turkey afterwards.
The week in Apple. What's going on? What's been big? What's been happening? This might go bad. AirPods and Apple Watches are called underpriced in order to bring new users into the Apple ecosystem.
Bullshit.
Exactly.
I read the story further and I thought to myself, that's not a bad shout to a certain degree. So you're only getting 159 for the AirPods, which is well below an awful lot of the other stuff. And also they're saying that if you think about the Series 1 watch at $269, that's actually quite cheap in comparison to a lot of the other stuff that's out there. And even the Apple Watch 2 at 38 millimeters is cheaper than the Garmin's. It is a drug sale, but it isn't expensive. It is fairly cheap.
So what they're basically saying is, I mean, I'm pretty sure Apple is still making money on them, maybe even their usual 30-40%. But what they're actually saying is that Apple could charge way more for them and people would still buy them. Is that about right?
The fanboys would buy it no matter what, wouldn't they?
Yeah, okay, that's true. But I mean, really, the masses.
There's probably going to be a holy relics type thing for stuff that Steve Jobs sat on in the future. You know, it's like you can so touch it and it'll cure cancer or something like that.
I still feel the watch is overpriced, regardless.
I don't know.
So much in series fact, one. I still feel it is. I still feel it's. If they could get it to under 200, like 189, I would be more tempted. But even with the first watch right now, the first generation, I still feel is overpriced. I think that's why they're not flying off the shelves.
Yeah, that's a good point. If they did the Apple Series 1 at 199, I'd replace mine when it was stolen.
There, see?
But I'm not now.
My point proven. Mm. But see, you haven't been in a hurry to go get it, have you?
I haven't missed my watch.
Exactly. And I think that's another reason, too. I mean, if the price would come down, I think more people would say, oh, yeah, I'm going to go grab that. At least I have something to add to my phone. But when they cost almost as much as, say, a new phone in some cases, not an iPhone. But
the steel was 600 a new quid. Phone. It wasn't cheap. And I loved it when I had it, but I haven't missed it. Doc, Adam being very quiet.
I don't like these kind of stories, regardless of who the brand name is, before Mueller Biker says anything. The terminology is called a value proposition. A price is a value proposition.
Go on, man.
There are people who buy a piece of canvas that has been waxed heavily and stamped with LVs on it and will pay lots and lots of money. It's still canvas. It's not dissimilar from your Chuck Taylors. But the value proposition for wearing something or having a suitcase or a steamer that says Louis Vuitton is worth a lot to the person who buys it, so they don't mind paying $2,000 for a piece of canvas that's covered in wax. So that's up to them. It's not like you're buying food or something for this price. When it comes to any type of accessory, if their value proposition matches your wallet, you buy it. And if it doesn't, it doesn't. Calling something expensive or not expensive and trying to, I don't know, make people feel bad or not bad for it is kind of silly to me. I just don't. I don't like these kind of stories.
I agree with that, and that's not what the whole story's about, though. See, I agree with that, and I actually think that the AirPods are very, very keenly priced. I think they're really, really good. But the story is about whether Apple are using the watch and the AirPods
as loss leader,
to pull people in, or not. It doesn't say loss leader. It says it's a way of getting you into the ecosystem. I don't understand how. I can understand how the watch gets you in the ecosystem, but not the AirPods because they're Bluetooth compatible.
Yeah, right.
Right. So Patrice kind of brought it up when he stated, that my brain just went retarded. Where Patrice was making the point that it's not necessarily lost leader because they're still making money on it. It is almost like the original conversation of the halo effect, right? When you saw the white headphones, you knew somebody had an iPod. And then the iPod was sort of equated with the cool kids. They originally kind of spread it out among the stores that were closer to the bigger universities. And then so, figuring that those people were the meta filters and the trendsetters, it became a thing. And that's why there's even a whole book about them and the whole nine yards. So I can see them trying to recreate some of that old muster. But again, there's plenty of headphones with cords in them that cost more than that. And it was kind of sort of considered for the longest time a decent set of headphones was $150, So, like, for someone to say, that they're overpriced or underpriced or whatever, they seem to be priced basically where they should be in comparison to the various things in the market that are in the exact same position.
Yeah, agreed.
That's what I'm trying to
say. Adam, do you have anything to add?
No, I mean, I'm in general agreement. I can see how the AirPods maybe a way to get people into the ecosystem, because in order to do the fancy, like pairing and stuff like that, you do have to have an iPhone. So it could be the kind of thing where someone buys them as a set of Bluetooth headphones and then realize that they like the design, they like the style, they like the simplicity and want that extra little bit of stuff. But that's a bit of a stretch. The only other thing I would say is that it's possible that you know, you could argue that they're underpriced then, and which is exactly what this piece is saying, right? It's like, if they were priced higher, then they wouldn't be loss leader. And Apple could potentially price them higher because you look at what we were talking about earlier with Patrice, where they're sold out. You know, they're constantly sold out. So that's always a sign, you know, economics 101, that you should be and could be and probably should be charging more, right?
Well, the only thing I'd say to that is, when the day I bought mine in Regent Street, they only had a delivery of two, and that was a long time after launch. So there is something else wrong, I think,
probably,
other than just the fact of demand, because they wouldn't be, they'd be manufacturing more to compromise the demand, and they're not.
I think there's another reason for the AirPods maybe being a little bit cheaper than you could expect from Apple, and that is the iPhone 7. That Apple simply said, okay, we should have something that's reasonably priced so people will not complain too much about not having the headphone jack.
I agree with that, actually, Patricio. I think that's the whole idea of it when you get into, particularly when you go into the store and say, well, we got the new iPhone. Well, you're definitely going to want these AirPods with them, too. You do realize you have no headphone jack, and who wants to carry around this little thing with you all day? And it's more of a... we've discussed this before on the show, Ewan, about you're at the checkout counter and, I need a pack of gum before I'm out of here. I kind of look at it that way, though I'm not comparing them to a pack of gum. I've yet to actually hear how good they sound, but from what I've heard, they do sound excellent.
They're awesome. Having heard, yes, good point. I'm just trying to find a picture because... I've been really impressed with them. They fit in my ears, and they generally don't fall out unless I'm eating.
Yeah. I mean, you guys have convinced me that I should get them, so the issue is only that I can't.
I can't get me bloody... Oh, crap. I'm trying to get a picture of me wearing... Now, but do you remember me getting some M-Tech ear molds made for my inner ear? And I was gonna use them in here in the studio, but then I noticed that they really, really fitted the old AirPods really, really well. And so I, for the first time this week, went out on the train and I took those with me to try and get some kind of seal, if you like, so that there'd be some kind of noise cancellation, if you like, with them. And I put them inside my MTECs and put them in my ears. And, oh man, the sound is unreal when you put them inside there because it gets just a little bit more bassy. And it's like being in a Dolby studio. And I couldn't, a theatre rather, and I couldn't have them above half volume because they were too loud off my iPad Pro. And that's the first time I can honestly say that I've ever had a set of earphones that I had to have at half volume because normally you get that pansy-ass kind of protection off the phone. And when you're in a noisy environment, it's like, come on, I want to turn them up. But these, I couldn't cope with it on full volume at all. I had to turn them right down. And they sounded incredible. They were absolutely unbelievable. So if you're umming and ahhing over buying a set of AirPods, just bloody do it. Just do it.
That's Nike.
Oh, that's Nike, yeah, spot on. You got to buy it, Patrice.
I actually tried whether I could get them here in Koblenz at one of the resellers, but they don't have anything. Zero. Well, so the next, I have to go to the next Apple store.
Look at me, Regent Street, so it's one of the main flagship stores in the UK. On first thing in the morning, I'm queued at the door, there's two available.
Yeah, that's... For Regent Street, that's basically the first 10 seconds of opening the store.
See if you can get some when you go and buy your aftershave.
I'm up 10.
two available, one for the left ear and one for the right ear. Is that what you're saying?
No, two pairs.
Sorry. That was a shit joke. What's the next story?
So, there's been no invites, there's been no announcements, but they're suggesting... 9.7-inch iPad Pro 2 as early as next week, and iPad Pro 12 as well as... And yet there's no fanfare, there's no event, there's no schwing-a-ding-ding happening at a theatre near you.
Kind of like the way the iPads are happening right now. There's no swing-a-ding-a-ding-a-dang.
I'm talking about the iPads.
They don't have any place,
they're not flying off the shelf.
Their new facility's not ready, and they don't want to use the old one. Tim Cook already said we already gave our last presentation at the Apple Theater.
Right, so they're just not going to have a launch. They're just going to do a soft launch, I think.
Yep. Yeah, I'm not saying that's why. I'm kind of half joking about it, but that could be.
It's not that far fetched, actually. Because right, I remember him saying that would be the last time that, you know, that was it, and the next time would be on Mars or something. But
the Steve Jobs Theater.
But that's
possible.
I mean, I saw the that's still a brownfield site, though. There's no landscaping. There's no hard.
Right, no, that's what I'm saying. It's not ready. The new theater is not ready. Exactly. The Steve Jobs Theater is not ready. And Tim Cook already said we're not having any more events in the old theater, which I think was just called the Apple Theater.
Yeah, but why would they still go to the Henry Ford, the Eddie Grant Theater? What's the name of the place? The preacher.
They typically do the iPad.
Billy Graham Theater.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Haven't they done the iPad event the last couple times on the campus?
Maybe I'm wrong. I thought it was the Billy Graham Theater.
I don't know, honestly.
I think Ewan's correct.
Mm-hmm.
For iPad, though, for an iPad launch, they've used Billy Graham Theater.
All right, let's propose a strange question. What if they just decided that they're tired of everybody critiquing it, and maybe research has told them that the live events don't really matter left or right whether they sell 1.5 million of them or not. So
really,
they just save the resources.
Discussion. Do you think they're going to drop the live events? That's a good choice, mate. Thank God there's no news. Come on, talk.
I mean, you think about it, when the live events happen, first of all, half the information has already been given out by my friend Sonny. I won't say his last name this week because I don't want Kyle to lose it again. So half of the information has already been disseminated by the speculative, you know, press, and whatever doesn't get talked about a thing becomes a panty twist for those who are looking for something to complain about, and expectations have either been left met or fall dead upon, and so it just becomes like another hot news cycle of complaining and whining and bitching by tech pundits. So what if they said, we don't need that, we're still going to sell the same amount with or without all of the unnecessary headache? It's like learning how not to pick fights with your other half, and anybody that has a long-standing other half have let some things that really irritate them go because it's just not worth being in that fight.
I think I almost agree with that. I mean, you got to add to the mix of the soup there that Tim Cook is just freaking horrible on stage.
Yeah, but I think he's recognized that, and he does an intro and then he walks off, and I think good on him. I think he's found his place, if you like, in those presentations.
I agree to an extent.
Hi, I'm Tim Cook. I can't be anything else other than the person that says hello. It's been really good, and then walks off stage.
That's awesome, Ewan. That's about exactly right.
And then he lets go for Ferengi.
Yeah, I mean, you just think about it. Like, how much complaining from certain people can you have till you just don't want to be around them anymore?
Well, now, hang on a second, because I think I'm fairly hard on Apple at times. I'm very honest about Apple in the way I feel about Apple. And when we've gone out and we've had Eddie Q dancing like your dad, and actually it was a really good keynote, but it went on too long, I don't think I've been constructively so much as just negatively about it. So I speak as it is, and I think the last couple, I think I've got to the end and I've said that was really good. I've given them credit for it, and I think they've got their live shit together, in quotes. So inverted commas.
I think I agree with you. I think
why like stop it? When you've just got? They've only just won me over, and they're going to stop. Come on.
I mean, I think the last couple ones we all agreed that it was all right. You know, it's pretty. It's not back to Steve days, but it's okay. But I still, you know, if you read the press from around those events, I mean, just go back and pick your top five sites and just go through them. I mean, and even Steve's partner, who half the time I want to punch in the neck, Dennis Sellers on Apple World today, like he just He just goes off on them like they stole his child.
Like, only half the time?
Oh, I don't think I'm that bad. I think I'm critical. But
no, you're good compared to what half the people are
doing. Me and Duck are going to have sex later.
Oh. Hey, girl.
Well, at least he already has his wood ready.
I got big monkey wood.
Wow. Well, that's what did it for me, mate. That was the pusher. That's what sent me over the edge.
Wait, Patrice, you didn't have anything to say about this topic, I wonder.
No, not really.
You think I'm crazy?
No, not really. For the most part, I agree with you.
Okay.
You think German Wi-Fi is the worst?
It's a huge loving this week. And whilst we're all pissing around, Adam's done the research. Thank you, Adam.
Yeah, the loop. Let Us Loop You In event was March 21st last year, where they announced the 9.7 iPad Pro on Apple's campus. So they have been having these events at Apple's campus. So this could be a reason why they're just going to do a soft launch, along with the other things that were mentioned. There's the rumor that the 10.5 inch one, which is the big redesign one, supposedly is not ready or not going to be ready at the same time.
I have another idea. Didn't Apple say that they would open Apple Park in April? Maybe this is the way to do it. To say, okay, we're gonna have an Apple event, but in April.
Well, it's already believed that this announcement might come in April, at the beginning of April. The problem is that the Steve Jobs Theater is not ready. So while they're going to be moving employees into Apple Park, that building, if you look at the images, it's not ready to go. So they would have to have it in maybe the end of April or even later.
You can tell Patrice isn't married, can't you? I'm going to move house and have a garden party the following day.
But no, that's exactly it. I think they probably wanted the event. They probably wanted to have the event in the Steve Jobs Theater. They probably thought they were going to, and they didn't line up another venue, and they don't want to have it in at the Apple Theater, which would have to be their fallback.
You could just see it, can't you? They organize the whole thing, and they're like, is it ready? And the contractors go, no, sorry. And Tim goes, not a problem. We'll just get some half-oil drums. We'll get some shrimp on there. everyone can come down. I'll get a megaphone. It'll be good. We'll be fine.
That would actually be very interesting.
You guys remember Tim's ice bucket challenge like last summer? It's going to be like that. Just a little party outside of Mac Cafe.
There you go.
Everybody get your iPads and we'll all sing Kumbaya together. Oh boy.
There'll be a calypso band with some oil drums going and playing as well. Eddie Q will be mirroring absolutely everything that Tim does because he's a brown nose. And
they really friggin' need is a Mac announcement. That's what they need.
Amen to that.
So are we talking desktop here?
Yes.
I'm talking anything with anything.
Come on, Adam, give us your dream machine spec.
No, I'm good. I mean, updated, it'd be great if they would update the MacBook Pros, but we're way overdue for iMac updates. We're way overdue for Mac Mini and Mac Pro updates.
We're not getting a MacBook Pro update. Not a chance, surely.
I think they should update the processors. I really do. Yeah, it'd be a soft launch update. Yeah. But they could do it at the same time. They do a Mac desktop announcement.
Yeah, second quarter Mac. According to what I've just typed in, second quarter of 2017 is going to be the Kaby Lake, but only up to 16 gig of RAM still.
No.
Bronwyn wants a new Mac Mini.
They'll go past that.
Isn't that an Apple TV?
I could see that. Could you see that? Actually, that's a good question, actually. Muller's just made a joke about it. Isn't that an Apple TV? No. But the processing capabilities, you could probably put a Mac Mini into a hockey puck now, couldn't you?
Oh, most definitely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So it's primed for a form factor change.
Yeah.
If Apple are bothered about a Mac Mini, they could easily do it into a very, very small form factor. I think they're going to have a hard time charging $500 for a hockey puck.
Because of the size or because of the technology it would take to put in there and get it at that price?
Yeah, I'm just trying to think in my own mind what kind of processor they're going to put in there, because at the moment you can get up to an i7, can't you? So it's
yeah.
They could do a Kaby Lake i3, right? Yeah.
Ewan, do you guys have gigabyte bricks over there?
Go on. How do you mean?
All right, I'm going to send you a link, because I got one of these. This is where it runs my laser, and it's basically only a half of a rat's tit bigger than a Apple TV. Where's my stupid? Oh,
here we go. I love the fact Doug says I'm going to send you a link right now, and there's me scanning the horizon like I'm looking for someone who's going to shoot me, trying to see which application it's going to pop up in.
I had to think about it. I was just about to send it in the text, and I realized I should put it in chat for anyone who watches this later. But this thing is really only a little bit bigger than an Apple TV 4th gen. And I have one literally stuck to the back of my monitor out there by the laser, because I'm treating it as sort of an iMac. And this is a Core i7.
So it's a bare bones.
Mine has 16 gigs in it, and I believe a 500 gigabyte SSD, like all into one little box. But it's tiny. It's 46 millimeters bands,
right?
Tall, and basically about 115 by 115.
Go on, Adam, question.
But I see those slots on the side, and I'm assuming that's fans.
Yeah.
Huh? No. There's gotta be some heat. It just lets the heat out.
Heat sink,
I have this exact box. It's just to let a little bit of heat out, but there's no fan in there.
With an i7, there's no fan.
Nope.
Yeah, so
I question that.
You don't think
I use it every single day. It doesn't make a sound.
Okay, that's cool. So it's 4K, it's genuine. Well, it's beyond 4K, isn't it? It's 4K at 60 hertz, which is good. Dual band wireless. It's got an Ethernet port in it, which is unheard of. And a mini display port, and HDMI, and USB 3. And it's bricks, BRIX. That looks really cool.
Yeah, it does, actually. Yeah. Are you all thinking what I'm thinking? I'm thinking Hackintosh.
And I'm thinking not Hackintosh, because I don't think you're going to find that the boxes are going to work.
It works.
Call them?
Not kernels. I'll send you the page, Kyle, how to Hackintosh one of these, because it does work. I just can't do it because my laser likes it.
You can Hackintosh these things?
Yes.
Oh, well. Send me the link as well.
Sweet. Heck yeah.
Stick that in the chat room, mate. Don't send it to Kyle. Don't keep this a secret. Damn no.
Sure, it's the
world. Well, do you guys know about Tony Mac 86 or Tony Mac X86?
Yeah. But the hardware is limited for Tony Mac, isn't it? Be careful, because the stuff that's on there, there is a hardware lineage that you have to stick to, otherwise it doesn't work.
Yeah, well, I mean, they have the instructions on this on that site.
But you can hack this very one.
Yeah. Yeah,
because that would solve me problems with my parents, because they're old iMacs dying a death, and I'm just like, I don't want to buy them an iMac. I just get them an old screen from somewhere and stick a Hackintosh on it, and they'd be over the moon.
That's the lead-in link. There's all kinds of various ones for various different gigabyte bricks, so you can look at any one of several out there. But yeah, there's people doing this all the time now.
Awesome.
There's another competing brand which name completely escapes me, but similarly the same type of thing. But these guys are really, really popular in, you know, you walk into a store like the old Microsoft store or even early Apple, where you have a bunch of really gigantic like 80-inch displays all tethered together as one and behaving as one. My friend's an installer of that, and he likes to use these as the master controller with that. And there's a software that's really expensive that ties it all together. But it allows it to switch from being one giant screen to every once in a while it'll turn into like nine individual screens. And then it'll go into 3-3-3 or like cross pattern, and all of that's controlled by basically one of these.
I'm getting 1,000 emails this week. 500 of them are going to be, can I have the link to that, please? And the other 500 are going to be, you bastards, how dare you talk about Hackintoshes on an Apple podcast? I'm unsubscribing. I'm gone forever.
Well, we're talking about a Hackintosh, people, because Apple doesn't seem to be making any right now, so screw it.
You know, Hackintoshes gained their popularity when they were being ignoring to the Mac Pro initially. Mm. And then people started trying to figure out how to do it with like smaller stuff, because at the time that the Dell 9 or Dell 10 was popular, we were having like a lull in notebooks. So almost every time the community has grown, it has grown to fill a void that Apple wasn't filling. And, you know, some people get mad and some people don't like it. I initially poo-pooed it till I tried it. Once I tried it, I was like, yo, this is really cool. And, you know, I was able to build a Final Cut Pro machine for like $1,200 that would run circles around my cheese grater, you know, and I was like, it's cool. You just had to be willing to want to play with fighting the ROMs and whatnot. But now I hear they're pretty flawless.
Yeah, they're in the UK store as well. I don't think we've got the full configurations like you have in what you've just posted, but they're in there. The BSI-3 is in there, but there's no i7s listed, as I can see. I need to have a dig around.
If I find the other company, I'll definitely send it to you guys.
I'm going to get another 500 emails this week, going, so you've turned Adam Doc, into an Apple hater.
I dropped you an image of that fan, it doesn't have.
Huh?
Adam's doing research today. That's why he's not talking much, and he's sending you a picture of the fan that's inside.
Yeah, I was going to say Adam's fixated.
No, in defense of Doc, he said it's really quiet, so it's a really quiet fan. Fine.
Yeah, but again, we're talking about bringing it back to what Apple will or won't do. They wouldn't put an i7 in theirs. They'd put it like an i3 because they wouldn't want to have a fan, and then everybody would be pissed.
But if you look if you're running a Mac Mini, generally speaking, what the hell do you need an i7 for? An i3 is going to do plenty.
That's true.
Right.
I'm
not arguing against it. I'm just trying to say this is the thing. It's like you can go out and find awesome PCs like this because they'll throw fans in and they'll do all these things that Apple engineering just will not do. So people like to try and draw a lot of comparisons sometimes. And I'm not saying that's what Doc is doing. I get exactly the point, but I was trying to bring it back to, yes, Apple could make a little hockey puck Mac Mini. I think that's very interesting and something they should do. But certainly, if they're going to do that, it's going to be SSDs. It's not going to have a fan and all of those things. I think what started this all off was you, when you were talking about, can they do it for $500? You know, are they going to have it at $500? And that's where the problem would be. Is they would want to over-engineer it and they wouldn't be able to sell it for $500 because of all these reasons.
They're not going to crack this together with old technology. I think the other thing as well that they've got with OS X is the fact that there is a big resistance, it feels to me, of them opening OS X up to other people to use. So if they then start to expand the base of hardware to which OS X is compatible, then it starts, lets the Tony 386 Mac stuff go ballistic, because then the amount of hardware that it will run on is infinitely bigger straight away.
Yeah, you're starting to get into Windows territory or even Linux territory.
Yeah, there's a two-edged sword for them. But I think the other thing to think about as well is what most people use a Mac Mini for. It was always the drug sale into using a Mac. I mean, it was my first Mac was a Mac Mini.
Me too.
G3.
Me too.
But I think it's beyond that now. It's not the first Mac for most people. It tends to be the utility Mac. You go out and you buy a Mac Mini because you want to run a home Plex server, or you want to run, something that's just light and easy, that can act as an email server for you or something like that.
You want to run an Apple server in general.
Yeah. So in terms of data or production load, you're not running Photoshop with it. You're not running Logic with it. You're not running Final Cut Pro with it. You're probably running something that would easily run on an AMD or something like that. It's incredibly low powered.
It's the dilemma they have, though, because it really has to serve both those masters now. And I think Apple's probably highly aware of that. You know what I mean? Like, it still is the entry-level computer for a lot of people. I mean, I bought one for my wife because we didn't want to spend a ton of money on a computer, and she doesn't have really high computing needs. You know, she's not doing Photoshop and stuff like that. So, and I have another one that in my house that's an old one that, you know, runs as a server. So I do think it kind of serves both those purposes, and sort of balancing that is tricky. And that price point is really critical for Apple doing it, which brings it all around to like what we're talking about. It's like they could do some really cool things. The problem is they're kind of locked in by a lot of these restrictions.
You know what the Mac Mini would be perfect for? If Apple ever decided to go to ARM on the desktop. Because of the reasons what Ewan just said. The uses that it's actually usually used for. Server running small, not too powerful things.
Right. I mean, like for Docs PNC application or something like that, Apple could do some amazing things if they wanted to, you know, kind of get into Raspberry Pi territory. Build a little Mac, you know, that's really cheap just to run as an embedded system,
mm-hmm.
you know, as a little mini server for doing lots of different things, you know, and they could sell them for a couple hundred bucks. But that's just an area they don't want to get into, I'm sure.
One thing I just did a little look-see in Amazon, they actually have an entire section dedicated to minis.
Right.
And as I was looking through here, there's something called an Intel Cherry Tail or Cherry Trail. So it was a weird name for a processor. But there seems to be a couple of new dedicated processors that will run the Windows and Chrome OSs that make for some really tiny minis here. There's even one, it's like it's called a Neo Z34. And it features the Intel Cherry Trail fanless mini PC. And I think that's the thing that's really perfect, what Ewan was talking about, because these are basically sold sort of as the home theater PC, you know, something you stick behind the TV and kind of ignore it, let it run the server, or use it as an in-house file server, print server. These guys are starting out at like $179. So it's actually cheaper than the higher-end Apple TV. But for reality's sake, it actually does more. Because it's a 4K box. So, like, I think this is something that I talk about for a while, looking at the notebooks, that we could totally take that out and turn it into an Intel-level stick. And D-Pan mentions in the chat room, he could totally see the Apple TV turning into a stick and the puck size turning into a Mac Mini. And so I would love to see Apple follow that.
I'm just straight off the top of my head there. I'm just sitting thinking now, is there an app? Because the Apple TV used to look like the Mac Mini, and
you know, true.
Just stick with me on this. So the Mac Mini and Apple TV used to look identical, and then the Apple TV shrunk. The Mac Mini stayed the same size ish. And then there's a bit of me thinking, if Apple's thinking about, because I can't believe that Apple hasn't seized on the home entertainment element further than what effectively is still its hobby. I mean, it hasn't really changed, does it? Apple TV is still a hobbyish type. You know, they don't seem to. There's no guaranteed upgrade cycle on it like there is mm-hmm. on MacBook Pros or other devices, the iPhone and so on. So is there a Is there an Apple thought process that they're saying, okay, actually, the next device we're going to bring out, we're actually going to get rid of the Mac Mini, and we're going to give you a Mac Mini come Apple TV experience? So mm-hmm. you take this little tiny device, you plug it into your TV, you can use it a Bluetooth keyboard with it, and it becomes the home computer for the family. It mm-hmm. stops you having to have the tablet on your coffee table. You can run your Wemo lights off at your smart home through it. It's got Home Hub in it. It's actually an active computer as well as, and it's effectively supercharging what is currently the Apple TV into something that really does fit the home Internet of Things type stuff. That would be magic. Why don't you employ me, Apple? Jesus, I'm good. Doc, I've got wood. Sorry, yeah.
Well, I didn't say anything.
Oh, I thought you were talking. Sorry, man. Who was talking?
Adam was.
Well, I cut off Patrice, but I was going to say real quickly, and then Patrice can probably take over. I think that's sort of what Patrice was alluding to. You know, this could be the first ARM-based sort of crossover Mac that bridges that Mac OS, iOS kind of gap.
Mm. Yeah, I'm not sure I agree with you, Ewan, on this. I mean, as someone who has used a PC or a Mac, even a Mac Mini at some point connected to a TV, I never felt that the usability of it was really good. And I mean, today with a 4K display, I'm not too sure this is really useful. Plus, I mean, you're really if you're using it as a, I mean, you're using the TV as a display for your PC, which probably in most families will mean that there will be a fight over, do we watch TV or do we use the PC or whatever, the Mac.
No, you see, but what I'm thinking is it's occasional. But go on, sorry.
What if it was a network PC or network situation where it was like a home hub and you could have, you know, a separate terminal that runs a separate user instance in the background and it's doing more than one thing?
Mm-hmm. Okay, I could see that. Yeah.
So my Mac Mini is connected to my TV, and the Mac Mini is running Plex, and whatever we're watching or whatever is coming through Plex via the Mac Mini, or through Netflix via the Mac Mini. But half the time I'll be remote desktop in, and I'm doing stuff like fixing the, you know, files in Plex where I named them wrong, or they ended up in the wrong folder because I forgot to set the ID tag. I'm rearranging my DJ library because that stores my DJ set. And so I might have a wedding, and if people are like hyper, like, you know, Christian, so I got to go absolutely make sure I pull all the explicit songs out. So I'm building like iTunes playlists and stuff while we're actually watching TV on the Plex because I'm remote desktop in, say, through my thing. And you just got to make sure you set it up so it thinks that there's two monitors so that your window doesn't pop up in the middle of the... But every once in a while, I get a notification from you guys and it comes up in the middle of the movie. But, you know, no biggie. I mean, I've been doing this for a long time.
DMD.
But Patrice is absolutely right, though. On a 65-inch Sony at 4K, the Mac Mini 2014... I have to take the icons and move them to 512. I have to take the text and set it, and it gets stuck at like 16 or 18 or something, which is messed up. So
yeah, that's because you're old, Doc.
Huh?
No, I think it's a general issue. I would have to, I mean, I'm every now and then I connect my server to my TV and I have the same issue. So I don't think it has something to do with age.
Yeah. I wish it did have a thing where it noticed it was a television and went into a GUI that was television better, and compatible or whatever. It's like, hey, I noticed this is a TV. Do you want me to go into like a TV skin? Yeah, dude, that'd be great. Because I don't need all of that menu stuff at the top, and it is really, really tiny. Like iStat menu, I can't tell you what it says on my TV. It's super
front row.
Stand right next to it.
Get rid of shoot, well, no. Shut up.
Isn't I'm that gonna, front row?
You say front row again, I'm going to kick you. Deep pan. Deep pan in the chat.
Go ahead.
Go on, mate. Go ahead. I'll get to deep pan in a second.
I was going to say, I mean, have a setup where you either can run TV OS or OS X, in a sense, something as such. The only problem I have with this, though, is I don't know if that's the type of company Apple is. Usually the Apple's the type of company that you go in, oh, I need this for my TV. They pull it off. This, it does it for your TV. Well, I need this, and this is for that. That's more of Apple in their ecosystem.
They're definitely not Swiss Army knife, that's for sure.
Yeah. No, they're not doing this. We're just pie in the skying, like, wouldn't it be cool if at this point. Never gonna happen.
Patrice, next time I've got Doc on the ropes, don't jump in and go no. Deep Pan, Ewan, instead of Apple TV, I could see them making the Home Hub as the router with all the devices, Apple TVs, iPads, etc., all running off it. Also, an Airport Extreme becoming more like a home server and using HomeKit, etc.
Yeah, that'd be great if they hadn't disbanded the team.
I know, that's what I was about to say. Yeah, that'd be great.
No, I mean, my Mac Mini is in the front office, the old office, where I used to do the shows from, and it's got a headless 4K into it, and that's it. It just sits in there, running away with a drive linked into it that's got all my movies on it that I've kept over the years. And if I need to, because thanks, Apple, every time my computer restarts, thanks to an update that is automatic, it doesn't restart iTunes. Mm. Wankers. Sorry. So I have to get I pull out my laptop, and then I can just remote screen share into it to turn on iTunes and then switch it off again, and that's it. And it just sits there and purrs away until it does the next update and it disappears. That if they had something that was, I think they could produce a home experience whereby, you know, you could use the facilities if you wanted, but it wouldn't necessarily have to be attached directly to the screen, and that one screen wouldn't have to be hogged by everyone. you know, there's a screen share like process that could go in through any TV. Yeah. That would be fantastic. And very doable, I might suggest.
And you could do that. You could do that for almost any application. You could say, "Well, I need." Funny enough, it kind of sounds like because I'm using Chromecast now. It sounds like Chromecasting. Well, I need the PC portion on here. But you guys are watching the video, so stick it over there, and maybe taken into Deepan's sort of suggestion. Everything is at a hub. That is the computer of the house. Therefore, you decide from your phone, from your tablet, where what goes where.
Yeah, this thing is not good enough to be a NAS drive or a server or something that everyone can process video on. It's purely for home entertainment purposes and satisfying the Mac Mini-esque kind of market that there is currently out there. If you're all sitting there and going, you bastards, you're talking about all these things and you're putting links in left, right and centre and I can't get them because I'm driving, don't worry. All you got to do is go to britishtechnetwork.com/chat and then navigate to the 17th of March and you can look at all the crap that we've been posting.
Mm.
Dead easy.
I actually like Deepan's suggestion here that instead of doing this for the Apple TV, it could become the router. I mean, basically the AirPod Extreme, but on steroids and good, actually.
Yeah, again, so. I'll just repeat, if Apple hadn't disbanded the whole AirPort team.
Yes. Sure, but I mean,
they're listening to this.
Who knows?
Right,
maybe they don't need that team anymore because now the Mac Mini team, if it exists, is doing that.
Well, we do need a better like HomeKit level hub, so maybe they're no longer the AirPort team and they're the HomeKit hub team / Apple TV / Mac Mini.
It sounds like a minor league baseball team. The home kit.
Oh boy. You know what's going to happen? All businesses are cyclic, guys. So in another couple of weeks, there's going to be one of the AirPort Extreme team is going to be at home cooking a barbecue, and their wife's going to come out or their husband's going to come out with the phone and go, "It's Tim Cook. He wants a word. He sounds a bit upset."
you stole my idea, you sons of bitches.
Been watching.
Oh, no, so do the next story or not. Apple Music Ambassador Program has enlisted students and recruiters to promote services in exchange for perks. Apparently, this is only in the UK, an Apple-only UK story. It's the first. Apple this week has started a new program called Music Ambassador, marketing campaign for streaming platforms, quietly recruiting students. It sounds a bit MI6. And giving them perks in exchange for promoting services. That still sounds like MI6. And recruiting others. New effort targets college students, specifically making them so-called official Apple Music Ambassadors on Twitter. So basically, they're basically getting these students, they're giving them loads and loads of crap, whatever that might be, perks, in inverted commas, and they're going around going, "Hey, Gov, do you want to buy a track?"
Street team. It's the Apple Music Street team.
Is that all it is? Mm-hmm. Mm. Oh, it sounds a bit nefarious.
Online.
It does. It sounds like an MI6 plot with Mata Haris to kind of get you into bed and give all the secrets up. I don't know. It didn't sound clean. You know what I mean?
So you remember what I said way, way back in the beginning about with the iPods? One of the things that they did really, really well with the iPod, and they kind of did it quietly, was make sure that all of the cool kids and all of the universities, especially ones where you had to catch the New York trains back and forth, would rock the iPods with the white cords. Everybody would see them and they'd be like, "Man, I like what that kid's doing. We go investigate what that is." And that really helped spread the sort of cult effect of the iPod when it first came out. And Apple's maybe number one competitor would be Spotify, which is from the UK. So if you wanted to place to do this, you wanted a place to try this and see if you could sway more people over to Apple Music from services like Spotify, there's no better place in the UK and there's no better place to do it than with the students that you know are on campus. You're picking the cool kids. They're the influencers. They're the hipsters. So much of what becomes trending comes from hipsters and whatnot. So why not? I think it's a genius program if it works. I don't know if it's
going to work. I'm wondering what they will offer as perks. Is it like pens, caps?
Well, in music, I can tell you when I worked at the radio station, because I managed the street team, you got backpacks with, branded with your group on it, right? So there's like a Metallica backpack. Inside that would be you know, CDs and tapes with J boxes and stuff like that. And you would tell them, okay, these are yours, and you get the special edition that comes with a little gold plaque and all this other stuff. And here's three cases of the same CD. I need you to take these to campus and hand them out at the cafeteria. And then if you can, if people have had the yellow Walkman, I was like, can you make them listen to it and get us a rating on the song and bring it back? That's sort of what we did.
I think you've cracked it, Doc. I think you've absolutely cracked it. Apple are going to get music ambassadors who are kids at school to sell Apple Music for them, and in return, those children are going to get CDs.
Yes, and Walkman.
They're getting free Apple Music subscriptions.
We'll give you Apple Music subscriptions.
No, that's just not funny.
Here's some iTunes gift cards.
Doc's suggestion's way more funny.
Yeah.
Sell our digital musical service. You can get CDs.
Yeah. I was trying to explain what a street team does and how you would just convert it to digital format.
If you sell 1,000, we'll give you vinyl.
Yeah.
And if you sell 10,000, we'll give you a cassette tape.
Yay.
Anyone who sells 500,000, 8-track.
Right on.
Oh, that would be so cool, man.
That would be amazing.
I would sell the shit out of that stuff to get an 8-track.
So anyway, for the people at home that are still following along and listening, one of the great things that was really cool for the street team members...
That was a Doc bitch slap, by the way. Carry on.
Yep.
if you're doing your job correctly and you were starting to, you know, sort of show merit for what you were doing, these guys got backstage access to the coolest concerts. And when we would take the artists out to dinner, we would bring our top street team members to the dinners with the artists. So when we have somebody in town, say like a Run DMC or, you know, even to the latest, you know, LL Cool J or, you know, Salt-N-Pepa, whomever we're doing concerts for, even Mariah Carey, we would take them out to dinner with Mariah Carey and get to meet her and hang out with her. And 9 times out of 10, they ended up being like a gopher for the major artists.
I thought you were going to say something else then. That's liable. You can't say that in the UK, mate.
You can't say gopher?
No, that you were going to take them to a Mariah Carey concert, and 9 times out of 10, they were going to get, and then just insert any activity you like here. Did you guys see Howard Stern the other week with Lady Gaga?
What did he do?
Oh, Lady Gaga can friggin' sing. I thought she was just one of the... Oh, man.
Yeah, she can sing, yeah.
Yeah, she sings. She did some Led Zeppelin.
I wish she would just leave the drum machines and all that crap alone and just go out and do it old school.
I posted a link in the chat room. There's a YouTube video, and I'll just play it. I'll play it in the room here and turn up the volume because she can really properly sing.
I didn't know you were in a Led Zeppelin cover band.
Yeah.
No kidding.
Hey, mama said the way you move gonna make you sweat, gonna make you groove.
There you go.
Do you know that Stephanie turned down Juilliard? She was accepted at Juilliard and she didn't go.
Okay.
No, that's a pretty impressive thing.
Yeah, Juilliard's good. Yeah, I've heard that.
You could, I mean, you would figure that if you're that level of musician, learning to play piano at 4 and then getting basically sort of asked to come to school from Juilliard at like 11 and telling them no, you would get blacklisted, but...
Yeah,
you know, she just went weird. She wasn't ready to do the thing.
Did she do the Super Bowl concert with live vocal? Yeah. She didn't record it like old Katie.
Yes.
That was pretty impressive then. Yeah, well done.
She didn't pull a New Year's Mariah Carey.
I'm not going to buy her music, but I wish she'd do some music that I would buy because she's got some great pipes.
The last
maybe you need to find her old cover band recordings.
That'd be good. Yeah, yeah, spot on.
No, seriously, you and the last album was not weird, and there's some parts where she actually does, you know, normal singing without doing any crazy stuff, and it's really good. And I never would say that live anywhere.
No, you say that. I don't mind the crazy stuff. I like the meat dress and all that kind of stuff. That was great. I loved it. But
that's because we grew up with Bork.
We've had some reviews. Thank you to those people who bother to leave reviews on the shows. We've got loads of reviews for the photo show. I need to read some of those out on the photo show. But I kind of kept the pace up on that because we only get sort of 40 minutes to get the show done. So thanks to those people who leave stuff on the photo show. Go and have a listen to the photo show. If you want to join the Fantasy Photo League, I'll tell you a bit about that later. But but you can join in as much as you like. We're on to the third month of the Fantasy Photo League, so it's construct, however you want to do it. Kyle's in it. Kyle, you got a vote last month, mate, for that oil painting shit that you sent in.
For the what now?
That oil painting picture that you sent in.
I thought we were supposed to be anonymous.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, man.
thanks a lot. Blew my freaking cover.
No, thank you. GB Redneck sent us a review. He said, this show goes up to 11. Professional productions.
Are you sure they watched it?
Behave. What more could you want? I've not bothered writing podcast reviews in the past, but the British Tech Network deserves a damn good pat on the back. Very late to the whole podcasting thing and started with Twit and wouldn't miss a thing. Watched live to probably half a dozen shows a week. Discovered Ewan and the British Tech Network and love it. Real people with real world use for the stuff they discuss. Not found a single guest on the show that makes me want to turn off and not listen. Really? Which is not how I feel about other podcasts. I think a lot of my enthusiasm, is, as many have said, it's a real UK-based slant, and they certainly aren't frightened to take the mick out of themselves. Must listen. Cheers, mate. If you'd like to leave us a review, stick it in iTunes, and we read out every single review, no matter how bad it is, unless it's libelous. In which case, then, send me your address and I can sue you, you bastard. This podcast and others is brought to you by UK2. Ian Lewis has just walked in, by the way, the man that does the photo show with me. He is here for the photo show in Birmingham, as in the photography show at the NEC. But he's here for the big show later, so tune in. You'll get to see his face then. You get to know what he looks like. He's wearing glasses. I don't need more glasses. Yeah. He's gone quiet. He's all quiet. He's sort of shy now. I hope you've got a story for the big show, dude. Because you're on it. Yeah. UK2, they support us. They're going to support us for an awful long time to come. So this crap will be peddled out far and wide. We've just done our SSL with them. So we are now a secure site. Yeah. And all of that was done thanks to their support. They're brilliant.
After all the hate we're going to get this week, we're going to need a secure site.
Yes. I long for a DDoS attack. If you'd like to support the network here and you like the fact that we provide podcasts relatively ad-free and free of charge, then please just look after the couple of people that do look after us, which is UK2, because they keep all the bandwidth and everything going and they keep all the servers up and running, along with the help of Anders and Wheaters and Wrighty and Camps. But if you can, please go back and buy anything that you like for your web through them. And also, please check out Hoya, the... I got an email this week from Mark that the Uniku machine is going to be here in April. And I'm going to be at the NEC for its unveiling. Ooh. Oh, boys. I'm going to try and live stream it if I possibly can from my phone. But I'm certainly going to shoot video there and stills and that kind of stuff. And there will be... something to look at on the shows afterwards. But the Uniku system is this thing from Hoya whereby they scan your face and then they produce frames that you like. You say, okay, I like these frames. But then they take those frames and they manipulate them so that they fit the contours of your face exactly so that the lenses are in the perfect, perfect position for you. And then those frames are manufactured as a one-off. These bespoke frames for your lenses. Hoya then make the lenses, they put them in the frames, and this set of glasses is unique. It is your face, perfectly.
Is that why they're called Uniku?
Uniku, there you go. I've got to say, I'm looking forward to this no end. It should be absolutely unbelievable. I can't wait to go. I'm there on the Monday, and I'm having curry and beer with all of them on the Saturday or Sunday, I think, I can't remember. I'm looking forward to that night. Right, time for the cool things. Do you have a cool thing for us, Dr. Octicus?
Yes, I do. I have an application that I've discovered and I'm absolutely in love with because I was born a hood rat. I don't know what you guys call that in the UK. Basically, someone poor from the ghetto. And I learned to cook at a really young age because I was the youngest child, so I was always stuck around my grandmother. And that lady had the capability of looking in the refrigerator and where I would basically see nothing And then like an hour later, we got a pretty epic looking meal. And I'm thinking, how did she pull that off? Because there's literally shite in the refrigerator.
And she was using this app in the 60s. That's awesome.
No, but I'm saying I fell in love with this app because it's sort of reminiscent of how I learned to cook from me gran. Hey, I said it the British way.
Anyway,
this app is called it's called Food 52, and I believe the official title of the app is not recipes. And basically what it allows you to do is you can say you look in your fridge and you got a thing of beans and you got a thing of spotted dick and you got to come up with a recipe. So you can just
of all the freaking puddings available to you, you had to pick spotted dick.
Hey, I was trying to keep it pretty.
He only did this review because he knew he could say that.
Oh man! We
you got beans.
Everyone in Britain has spotted dick.
What?
Everyone in Britain has spotted dick.
Well, would you if you go out on a Saturday night?
Hey, I'm allowed. Well, to be more in Newcastle, maybe. Now, have you seen our president? That dude's an a-hole. Anyway, so you can basically put in the things you have, and it helps you generate the kind of like ad hoc, not really recipes, but like what's the word I'm looking for? You just throw something together and you come up with something epic.
Not recipes. What's the word I'm looking for? Recipes. Yeah, we're looking for the word recipes.
It's like how to get creative out of only thing that you have left, and it helps you figure these things out. Anyway, it's a really fun app, and the primary goal of it was to teach people to cook again without the fear of looking in the cookbook and seeing all kinds of ingredients in there that you might not know what it is, like a half a third of a sapphire leaf. Or saffron leaf or something like that. So this lets you kind of just see.
And it's not a leaf.
I was meant to say saffron. Sapphire, I don't know where that came from. Never mind.
Half a third of a saffron leaf. That saffron's not actually a leaf anyway.
I know it's a root or a string. Whatever.
It's a stamen, mate.
Yeah.
It's what?
It's a stamen.
A stamen?
Stamen. S-T-A-M-E-N.
Yeah. That's a sex organ.
Part of the flower.
It is. It's part of the flower sex organ. Oh, you're eating.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're eating flower cock.
Yep. Spotted dick. Okay. See, I was on to something. Saffron spotted dick. It's a new recipe. You can find it. You can find it in food. Oh, anyway, the app is for iOS, and the thing is called food.com. And it's pretty epic. So if you're like Patrice and I and you'd like to get your experiment on in the kitchen, it is well worth a look and it doesn't cost spotted dick.
Yeah. I actually use Food 52 quite a lot. It's a good source.
Then help me out, Patrice, because you are just kicking ass right now.
I wouldn't mind, but Ian Lewis has not even cracked his cheeks. It's like...
He can't hear it, that's why.
Oh, he hasn't got it on. Oh, man.
Is it Ian Lewis, the guy?
Show title.
Isn't Ian Lewis what?
The guy in the C-3PO costume.
No.
No.
That was a joke. I know who Ian Lewis is.
I'm sitting here thinking I'm crying and Ian Lewis has just got a stone cold sober face and I'm like, oh no, it's just the Guinness.
Ian Lewis, Anthony Daniels, same.
Close enough. Oh, mate.
You guys just peed all over my spotted dick shape.
Only because you picked spotted dick and flower cock.
God.
Oh, man. Well,
I tell you what, we're going to have the longest show title ever. This is
if
the last
anybody
week.
Anybody from Food 52 is listening to this. I was on your side. He messed it up.
Oh, mate, now you need to send this the link to this podcast to them because this is the ultimate endorsement.
For their app.
For their app, yeah.
Yeah.
This will be on their website. It's going to go viral, man.
I'm sending it to them. By the way, I tried beans and toast for the first time, and I just made it because I was bored and I just wanted to try it. So I tried it. It's freaking epic.
You made what? Toast?
Beans and toast.
Okay, so you've had Heinz beans on toast for the first time?
Yeah.
At 50?
I didn't get... I didn't get what all the rage was about. It's like, this is super ghetto, but I was just going to try it. It was freaking good.
Oh, man, that's just the start. That's like level one. So you need to do now. So the next thing you need to do is a smear of Marmite underneath it and then put the beans on.
I used it all. Because I liked it. Mate,
the one that you need it. To, we'll get you some Marmite, dude. But you got to do beans on toast with Marmite.
All right, let me check.
Egg on toast with Marmite. Oh. Mate, it's just that's you're going to blow your mind now. Forget your 52 thing. Actually, what happens when you put Marmite into food 52?
I don't know. Let me think.
Just blows up.
Is it M-A-R, right?
M-A-R-M-I-T-E. Give us, come back to us after Adam's pick. Oh, what's up?
Mine's going to be quick, and I can never remember. We've been doing this show so long, what I've picked and what I haven't picked. So this may be a repick. But I mentioned earlier that I was deploying code out to a server. And so I'm going to nerd out. I'm going to give you a nerd pick this week, mainly for programmers and developers. But if you use Git or GitHub or any service for managing your code resources, you need to have Power, Git Power. Mm-hmm. Which is a GUI interface, graphic user interface, for interfacing with a Git server, basically, for version tracking. So it allows you to keep track of all your code. If you mess something up, you can go do rollbacks. You can do track your changes and your differences. And it's just something that I, as a developer, absolutely love. You could do all this from the command line, of course, but Power just has an amazing interface. It interfaces with Bitbucket and GitHub and all of your Git servers out there very easily. You can put in all your credentials. You can put in your SSH credentials and keys and things like that. And it just makes managing and version controlling and deploying your code with Git super easy and nice on the Mac. And they now have a Windows version too. So
cool. Windows, you can do it. Git-tower.com/Mac. $80. Is that a good price?
Very good price.
I picked this like 3 years ago as one of my first or second picks on the show, and it's awesome. Been using it for a long time. I got it from Brett.
If you're a version one user, then it's only $39.50.
So yeah. There you go, Doc. I mean, if you've been slogging around in the terminal and stuff like that, I can do all that stuff from the terminal, and you can figure it out. But again, I like knowing what's under the hood and then finding a really nice GUI that goes on top a lot of my developer tools, so I don't have to deal with it.
And I mean, the visualization of what's going on is really important, and that's something you lose on the command line. You get the same information, but it's simply not the same.
Muller's not laughing at your pick at all, Adam. He's laughing at the fact that...
I don't know what he could laugh
at. Well, what he's laughing at is the fact that Doc has used the word Marmite in Food 52, and he's come up with a dish that's got dumplings in it. Couldn't get worse.
What's wrong with dumplings?
Dumplings, no, because dumplings is another word for a lady's frontage appendage. So...
You guys are strange.
Man. My UK dictionary is growing every day.
And you thought you cracked it when you just said me.
Just tell him you have a fanny pack.
Fanny, that's another word that's not good here as well. For Christ's sake, save us, Patrice.
I don't know whether I can.
Based on the pick that you've picked, you can.
Okay, good. My pick is this week is something I've been using the entire week. It's a app called MindMeister. It's a really, really, really good mind mapping tool. I've been working with this the entire week, as I mentioned, with I think three countries, and there wasn't even a single issue, single hiccup, anything. And it is really, really easy to use. It's powerful. It's everything you want in a mind mapping app. They have, if you go with one of the paid options, they have a million import and export options. And it's just amazing. And I use it all the time for work. And I can just highly recommend it. It's really, if you're doing mind mapping, this is the, in my experience, the only app you should ever use. And it's fully collaborative. I mean, we've been, as I said, 4 or 5 people in different countries have been working on the same map at the same time. Not a single issue. No, I mean, nothing.
Does it use translation? Because that would be, if you were in 7 different countries and you could type something in and it would translate for the other people on the other side, that would be incredible.
No, it doesn't do that. But I mean, we were all on a video call and we were all talking, but working on the same map, so we didn't need that. But it, as I said, I mean, it was really amazing and it's so easy to use. I mean, it's literally, you don't even need probably more than 10 seconds to understand how this thing works.
So is the collaboration what sets this apart from something like Thoughts?
Yes. Yes,
yeah.
100%.
That was going to be my question, is have you used other tools and how does this
work? Yeah, I have. I mean, XMind and iThoughts and so on. I've used a million other tools, but this sets it apart in really being web-based and being collaborative. And it works on an iPad. I've used it on an iPad a couple of times. Flawless.
Yeah. So, and the pricing's all SaaS, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so £6 a month for personal, £10 a month for pro, and £15 a month for business.
Per user per month.
Sorry. Yeah.
There's a free, I was the only one this week who had a license and it was fine. I mean, there's a free tier and it's good enough for things, what we were doing.
That's a really good question then. So is the per user thing, so if you're the license holder and you create the doc, can you invite anyone that's got an account to come in and share?
Yes.
Or do they have to have the same level as you?
No, if I remember correctly, I haven't done this in a while. I think the limitation is if I share with them, they need to have a free slot. I think you get three free maps. And if you have 2, then you can do it. If you have 3, then you have to archive or delete one of the existing maps. You can export and import them later, so it works. But for the, the advanced features are usually, I mean, exporting options and all of that, and one license is enough for that.
You know, Patrice, when these guys launched years ago, I used to use this, and my problem was exactly what you just said. I was using it with a guy that was doing a building construction project, and I was trying to help him figure out how to use tech to tie all this stuff together. Mm-hmm. And he refused to sign up for the thing, and so our map got too big, and then it just became a mess. But the prices come way down. It was way more expensive when it first came out. Yeah. And I think it might be better, but that was my original problem.
Yeah, I cannot tell you 100% how it is working today because I've been a paying customer for at least 1 or 2 years. So maybe that has even changed how this behaves. If you simply send out the link, maybe you can simply use it for free. I don't know. I don't think anybody in my group this week signed up. So maybe it's simply working with the link now.
Yeah. It's good though. It's super, super good.
Cool. Kyle, what have you got for us?
I've got an app today. Now that everybody knows my style of photography in the Fantasy Photo League, I thought...
No. Sorry, I'll delete that bit.
No, you don't have to.
I'll edit.
It changes from week to week anyway. So, I was looking for an app that I can get a little bit more control over things, and I don't really know what I'm doing anyways, and I thought that I need something that's simple, but yet gives me a little bit of pro features, and I came across this called Manual. It's actually a raw custom exposure camera app, but it's $4, so it isn't cheap, but it's not expensive either. It can give you full independent of your shutter, your ISO, white balance. I think one of the biggest come-ons is it shoots in full raw DNG capture. That's not so big to me, but it might be big to a lot of people out there. And I just want to help improve my capture abilities. I don't know how you, I guess it's how you'd say it. So I can get a little bit more points, maybe.
It's an interesting thing, I think, because actually the amount of the lack of support for the raw output that Apple seem to have done, it's only the third party developers that seem to have latched onto it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of interesting.
I'm gobsmacked that Apple have have clearly, you know, gone for capturing all the data that there is on the sensor and then not used it in their own stuff to the fullest possible degree. I know you can do raw light manipulation in photos, but it doesn't feel like they've done anything with it. It's only the third-party developers that have. So, I mean, it's a great pick at $4.
That's how I looked at it.
That's by intent, though.
Why?
Because I think Apple wants to be about their camera app, and everything they're doing is for the quote unquote average user. It's just simple and easy to do. And then they opened up the raw stuff to the third party developers to build more powerful apps, you know, where it makes sense. So, you know, I think a lot of people who buy an iPhone, they just want to snap a picture and throw it in iCloud, and that's about it. You know, and so for Apple to spend a bunch of time on the raw stuff within their own apps probably doesn't make a lot of sense, because they can leave that to third-party apps. And I think it's good for them to leave that to third-party apps, because then you get good apps like Manual and some of the other apps that are out there that are really powerful, and it leaves a market for third-party developers.
Okay, fair point, I suppose. But well, the third-party developers are really coining it, so that's that is good. So well done to them.
I mean, Adobe's done a good job supporting it in their stuff.
Yeah, definitely. Good stuff. My cool thing, I've struggled to find something that's really Apple-based this week, I have to admit. I'm not particularly good. But I have come across these. I've done a lot of conferences this week, and I've had a fair few devices kicking around that I've needed to use AA batteries on. And normally I'll just go down to the local supermarket, or I'll go down to the local Costco and I'll buy packs of Duracell. And the local Costco has got, you know, 50 Duracell batteries for like 20 quid, and they last really, really well. But if you put them in the audio packs, they kind of crap out after about half a day of constant use. With audio traveling over them. And the one thing I've used this week, which isn't, is Duracell Industrial. Now, they're at the moment on Amazon, on Prime, and you get 50 Duracell Industrial batteries for £15.15. And you're thinking, well, okay, that's fair enough, but you just said you paid 20 quid for 50 from what's the difference? Two of these batteries will power my audio units for the entire day. So effectively, I'm paying £15.50 for what would be the equivalent of 100 batteries at the other price. Mm-hmm. And I don't understand how Amazon are doing it, but they are. There you go. But Duracell Industrial...
No overhead.
Well, maybe, okay. But Duracell Industrial will last twice as long. Yeah, but I would have thought Amazon and Costco wouldn't be any different in terms of price, but they are. And they don't do these. But there you go. Mm. That's it. Amazon, Duracell batteries. Ewan picked Duracell batteries as his pick on a Mac show. I'm sorry, guys. I couldn't think of anything else.
You can't get any further away from Apple, but, you know, what the hell?
Apple have got to do something that's powered by a battery, surely.
I used to love the Apple recharge.
You don't have Apple's batteries? I have Apple batteries.
They used to have Apple batteries. Yeah, you take them apart, and I think it says Energizer underneath, right?
Probably.
They still make those, Adam?
Do they? They still
mine still work. I just charged them. I found mine in a box, and I charged them up, and they still work. And I swear to you, I bought them day one that they started selling those batteries. It used to be in a keyboard, and that keyboard long since died, but the batteries still work.
Mm. They're just they're the any loops.
No, yeah, see, these aren't rechargeable. Yeah. These are throwaways.
No. I know that, but I'm just saying.
And I've got the Apple Eneloops.
Does make batteries.
And the Eneloops would last all day as well. If you bought the Eneloop Pros and charged them up, they would last all day. But the problem is, once they've been off the charger for a week, they don't last all day. They only last half a day. And that's the big problem I've got with Eneloop. I've invested heavily in Eneloop, and I've been really disappointed, because unless you literally pull them straight off a charger and put them in a device, they're not much better.
Mm-hmm. I tried to do the same thing with my equipment, you know, especially my flashes and whatnot, even my microphones.
You can't use Eneloope in flash.
Yeah.
Because you will kill them.
Not strong. It was not working.
No, it's the flash recharge that kills them. So when your flash goes off, the backward current kills them. Mm-hmm. It discharges them, and you'll get virtually nothing out of an Eneloope. And they take forever then to recharge, ready to shoot again. You'll kill your battery if you use those. They're not built for it. But these work perfectly in flash.
I haven't actually had any issue with that.
With Eta Loops.
Yeah, and in my flash, I mean, I've shot a couple of weddings and so on, and I use Eta Loops and no problem at all.
I don't know. I mean, well, I've used them in a flash, and I threw them away in the end because they wouldn't recharge.
Okay.
So I figured it was a back current that had done it.
Yeah, might be right. Might be true.
Those batteries are great.
I use EverReady because I'm a cheap bastard.
EverReady? Do they still make? Are those from 1980?
No, this is brand spanking new.
Did you emigrate from America with those in your case?
No, they're still made here. This is manufactured here in the Philippines.
Yeah, could you not? EverReady. The packaging EverReady still printed the USA there as well. Became Energizer. It's the same brand. They just changed the name.
Yeah, it is. It's changed the thing. Yeah. Yep. Manufactured here. My goodness gracious, works great in remote controls for about 6 months.
Cool. Yeah. GB Redneck is in the chat room, and he says he's got those batteries. He uses them for his home automation kit, and they last forever. And Hobbs says he uses the Eneloop Pro for shooting with flash at events, and he doesn't have a problem. It's obviously just me. Eneloop clearly dislike me. I don't know what I've done to them, but where can we get a hold of you, Doc?
I was going to say something messed up, but I'll leave it alone. You can get a hold of me all over the internet. It's at DOCROCK and hanging out on this channel, getting harassed by you lot.
It'd fit right into this show, mate. Adam, where are you, pal?
You can find me at MacCast, MacCast.com, MacCast on Twitter, and pretty much MacCast every place else, and also every week on the iOS show at theiosshow.com.
Good, mate.
And there's those batteries available at Best Buy. I could pick them up today. The Apple white charger with the batteries.
Oh, cool. Righto. Deep Pants put old school every day, ever readies in Amazon. maybe Ewan's flash taxes. Mine's the Canon 600. Patrice, where are you, mate?
As always, every week here on the Mac Show, and everything I do on thepatrice.com.
Yeah, you wouldn't mind, but you sit here on your own for 6 days a week.
I don't think that's a good idea.
Sitting, thinking of Stamen.
Uh-huh.
And what you can put it in next.
I give up.
Kyle, where are you, mate?
Does it matter now? Kyle Swagger.
That moment has passed.
Yeah, it is. KyleSwagger.com, at Kyle Swagger Twitter, BTV all over the Philippines, and then, of course, the new show throughout the week here on the BTN Network.
Every fudging day you do the news show for us, mate.
And except for Thursdays, because awesome. Traffic just... I get home like at midnight on Thursdays.
There's never any news on Thursdays anyway.
Okay, well, good. I don't feel so bad now.
No, don't worry about it. You don't feel bad anyway, I hope.
It's not a traffic news, though.
No, I'd rather sit and do the news show than be stuck in traffic for
that amount of time. What you need to do is do the stories, get them ready on a piece of paper, and when you're sat doing absolutely nothing, turn the microphone on the phone, and just record one. Just do this the once. Just record it from the car and post it the following day or something.
Okay.
Just to see
I'll
what it would be.
God knows I'll have enough time.
It would be a Bomber McAllister moment. When I did the news show, I used to record it in hotel rooms. I'd wake up, I'd set an alarm when I'm in a hotel room. I didn't have to be at work till 9. And I'd set an alarm for 5 a.m., sit and do all the stories. And then I'd pull the duvet off the bed and I'd have two cushions either side, or two pillows either side of the microphone with the duvet over my head. So I've got like a little portable studio to record the stuff in. It was great. I miss doing the new show. I have to say I miss doing the new show, but I don't miss the amount of time it took. So, Kyle, you're a Trojan, mate. Absolute Trojan. If you'd like to listen to the new show, it's regularly now in the top tech podcasts in iTunes. You can find it dead easy. And it's well worth doing. It's 5 minutes of the best updates that are out there for tech for the day. And Kyle does it brilliantly, far better than I ever did it. My name's Ewan Rankin. You can get me at Ewan Rankin on Twitter. We won't be here next week. There will not be a Mac show, but there might be a kind of mashup big Mac show type thing going on with Righty Boy. We'll have to wait and see. So see you in 2 weeks. Hope you're all well. Have a good time, and we'll see you when we're back. Thanks for listening.